Man is a path road, sir.
Congratulations, and your band is as good, if not better than ever.
Thank you, sir.
For the year 2016-2017. The prefectorial system consists of a head boy, head girl, vice head boy, vice head girl, and house prefects who are given definite responsibilities and play a significant role in the organization of the numerous activities of the school life and are recognized as young leaders of public opinion. They become synonymous with excellence, innovation, honor, integrity, and outstanding quality and service. Therefore, they shall go forth with indomitable house spirit to meet challenges of the future and be proud Laurentians forever. Our headmistress, Mrs. Sangeeta Cheema, will now introduce the chief guest to the eminent gathering.
Mr. C. Aryama Sundaram, Senior Advocate of the Supreme Court of India, Old Laurentian, 1972, Sumeru House, our chief guest for the investiture ceremony. I can see Mr. Gundan, Mr. Balagopal, Winnie Balagopal, who were our chief guests earlier, Marcos, not here? Okay, you're there nevertheless. Lots of old Laurentians from the class of 72. Well, there's Dr. Chhabra, Mrs. Enos, I can't miss you, members of the Nilgiri chapter, Mr. and Mrs. Selvapakyam, Mr. Denzel Prince, I'm sure is around, and of course, Mr. Pramod Page. So it's always heartening to have so many old Laurentians in a gathering such as this. I would also like to very warmly welcome the proud parents of our prefects. I know it's a very special day, and what they do for this year, that experience will take them forward in their lives. All the students, you're here to witness something that is so very solemn and important. And of course, the members of our staff. I must also very cordially welcome the class of 2016, who have been able to spare some time to be witness to this wonderful ceremony. Year after year, the Lawrence School Lovedale watches and witnesses with solemnity and grace the glory of youth, an expression of immeasurable opportunity to define and redefine school culture. Year after year, the halo of recognition and achievement circles around the hearts of young leaders. And on this 23rd day of March 2016, we bask in the aura of the investiture ceremony as it happened many decades ago, in the inception of this profile of red bricks. Once again, it is a historical moment, with young minds being valiantly honored with responsibility. Ladies and gentlemen, students, with great pride, we welcome one of our eminent old Laurentians, a product of this magnificent past emerging in the luminous present. It is a moment of great honor, a stirring and inspiring experience to have an old boy come back to school as our very special guest. Let this large hall, this capsule of time, reverberate and echo with a resounding applause to welcome Mr. C. Aryama Sundaram, an old Laurentian from 1972, as our honored chief guest this evening. Born in 1957, C. Aryama Sundaram finished his schooling from the Lawrence School, Lovedale, in 1972. The year keeps coming back. A gold medalist in philosophy from the University of Madras, he completed his law from the Madras Law College and was enrolled as a lawyer in 1980. A debater, a theater actor during his college days, he continued with interests such as golf and riding, coupled with other interests which dealt with elocution and theater. He set up his own law firm in 1984, together with some colleagues, and continued as a partner there till he was designated as a senior advocate by the Madras High Court in 1995, the youngest ever in the history of the Madras High Court. This is no streak of luck, just a manifestation of a genius. He thereafter moved to Delhi to the Supreme Court, where he appears in cases covering all areas of law, almost omniscient, his favorites being constitutional, commercial, and corporate. He has appeared in a number of landmark cases, including the Supreme Court striking down death penalties, where there was an inordinate delay in considering the mercy petition. He continues his unwavering interest in public life and is often seen debating on the news channels, on topical issues, and voices his perceptive comments in articles for newspapers. For leisure, he travels, reads, enjoys music, and of course, concerts and theater. The aesthetic drive in him has made him an avid collector of art. Mr. Aryama Sundaram, your fraternity of Laurentians are deeply honored to welcome you back to school. A childhood fantasy expression goes like this, and I'm sure most of you youngsters have this thought in your mind. Perhaps one day I will be famous. And then the other one says, no, perhaps I will be more famous than you. Well, you have a famous Laurentian amongst us already. You see him on primetime TV almost every day across all channels. Wonderful indeed. The skills that you learnt in school, college, and in life, analytical, creative, logical, interpersonal, all of it has given you everlasting expertise in an ever-challenging profession which demands sharp intelligence and astounding expression. I have a snippet which I'm going to read out from a book which actually wraps up all that we need to know about this magnificent personality on stage, old Laurentian from the class of 1972. It was simply unbelievable, unimaginable, and unthinkable. Can people really be this callous? Can institutions ever be so indifferent? Can one's profession be deemed above humanity? These thoughts weighed down on Aryama Sundaram's mind while he was listening to the man in front of him. The man recollected and relived his traumatic experience with a sober expression. But even as Aryama Sundaram, today one of India's topmost lawyers, heard the painful tale, kept thinking to himself, why is he telling me all this? Why does he expect me to listen, and what does he want from me? When the gentleman finally finished his narrative, there was a stunned silence. The only thing Aryama didn't want to do was to demean the man's purpose in life. The man narrating this heart-rending tale was an international table tennis champion, V. Chandrasekhar. What transpired later was Sundaram's career's highlights, as well as the biggest and the most controversial cases to rock the country. It was a medical malpractice suit, one of the first of its kind in 1986. The trial lasted 5 years. The end culminated in victory for both Mr. Chandrasekhar and Mr. Aryama Sundaram. He belongs to a generation of lawyers, 5 generations of lawyers. He was greatly impacted and influenced in his life by his grandfather, Mr. C.P. Ramaswamy Iyer, or Sir C.P. And I am told this evening that Sir C.P. lived and settled in Ooty. He was a statesman in his retired years. He went on to become the Vice Chancellor of the Banaras Hindu University, as well as of the Annamalai University. And he made sure that his little grandson took up law. His granduncle, Mr. C.R. Pattabhiraman, was also the law minister in Indira Gandhi's government in 1960s. But when Mr. Aryama Sundaram chose to take on law and practice law, there was no one in the family to support him. He was there on his own caliber. He even took important decisions of moving from the Chennai bar to the Delhi bar. Ladies and gentlemen, and all students, the prefects-to-be of this year, 2016-2017, we in Lovedale are greatly honored to have such an eminent personality amongst us to share time and space for this very, very important occasion that enforces the Laurentian culture of never giving. Thank you.
Now, we have the oath-taking ceremony for the head boy and the head girl. The headmistress will administer the oath of office to the head boy, Ayan Ali Shah, and the head girl, Trisha Banerjee.
Do you promise to maintain discipline, lead in the right way, and uphold the honor and good name of our school?
I also promise to discharge my duties honestly and impartially.
By virtue of the power vested in me as the headmistress of the school, I appoint you as the head boy and head girl of the school for the session 2016-2017.
The chief guest and the headmistress will now confer the epaulets to the head boy and the head girl. The headmistress will administer the oath of office to the vice head boy, Daksh Nathani, and the vice head girl, Sagarika Das.
Do you promise to maintain discipline, lead in the right way, and uphold the honor and good name of our school?
I solemnly promise to maintain discipline, lead in the right way, and uphold the honor and good name of our school. I also promise to discharge my duties honestly and impartially.
By virtue of the power vested in me as the headmistress of the school, I appoint you as vice head boy and vice head girl of the school for the session 2016-2017.
The chief guest and the bursar will now confer the epaulets to the vice head boy and the vice head girl. We now have the oath-taking ceremony for the prefects of the various houses. Our headmistress will administer the oath of office to the newly elected house prefects.
Do you promise to maintain discipline, lead in the right way, and uphold the honor and good name of our school? By virtue of the power vested in me as the headmistress of the school, I appoint you as the prefects of the school for the session 2016-2017.
The headmistress, housemaster, and the housemistress of the respective houses and the mistress in charge of girls' school will confer the epaulets to the prefects of the various houses. Aravali House, Yash Johan Prasad, Sanket Malu, Shreya Alaparthi, and Tejashwarya TG. Nilgiri House, Shaurya Vardhan, Swaroop Kumar, Amshu Medapa, and Sapna Kataria. Sumeru House, Aaron Thambi, Anand Singh Janeja, Radha Singh, and Sneha Priyadarshini. Vindhya House, Murad Gill, Ayush Kumar Swankar, Ramsha Hassan, and Anjali Chabrolu. We now invite our chief guest, Mr. C. Aryama Sundaram, to address the gathering.
Madam Headmistress, Ms. Jima, who's been far too kind and far too generous in her introduction of me, Mr. Bursar, our heroes of today, the head boy, Vice Head Boy, Head Girl, Vice Head Girl, and Prefects, parents of the school, staff of the school, my fellow old Laurentians who are here, and last but not least, the backbone of this great institution, the people, the students, who make and will continue to make the name of this institution rebound and resound through the country. It was more than 40 years ago that I left the school. I recollect that at the time I left, after writing my last examination, I was filled with great excitement, of course. I was filled with expectation. And above all, I was filled, or at least a doubt niggled in me, of uncertainty as to what the future is going to bring, as to what is going to happen to me hereafter. I'm sure all of you students, when you leave at the end of your stint in the school, will have similar feelings. Of course, my generation was far luckier than all of you are. For one thing, we were far more structured. Another, well, this is not tongue-in-cheek, but we were far more obedient. So we usually knew by the time we left the school what we were going to do. And it was very simple. You're a professional, you're a doctor, lawyer, engineer, accountant, you will join the armed services, you'll become a bureaucrat, and you on your side can join your father's company, become another professional, or become a businessman. Today the world has changed. The world has changed so much because there are new areas which were never known of, thought of, and which have been discovered. You have the area of mass communication, of IT. You have the entire new world of so much of telecommunication. You have vistas and avenues which you can excel in and do so brilliantly, professional career paths which were never thought of before. All these are available to you. And to each one of you, there is that opportunity by which each one of your abilities
your achievements will count. And although we are here today on this very solemn occasion, when some amongst the students have been selected by the school as the people to lead the other students for the rest of the year, remember that in each one of you there is a leader. Each one of you has qualities, has abilities, has future areas of achievement which can always also and will always make you leaders in whatever you do. And to the prefix of today is that added responsibility. Because what you're going to be judged by at the end of this year, when those epaulets come off your shoulders, is what did you do in the last year? And the answer will be, where did you get every student of the school who you were asked to shepherd? The answer will be, how many of the students of the school worked to their maximum, achieved their maximum, showed the greatest respect and regard, and collectively, where did the school reach? There really cannot be any leader who can be judged except by the people who are with him. Alexander the Great once said, "I fear not an army of lions led by a sheep. It is the army of sheep led by the lion which I am afraid of." Because within each of us is the ability, the capacity to do anything, and it is for the persons who assume the role of a leader, whose duty it is to bring out the best in the students. And the best is not brought out in fear. The best is brought out by co-opting every single student to ensure that every student's needs are also met by you, are safeguarded by you, and that you, at the end of your tenure as a prefect, will be able to say, "I did the maximum for all the students I was asked to shepherd, and I am proud of what I did in that regard." It was Dwight Eisenhower who said, "You do not become a leader by hitting people on the head. That is assault, not leadership." What really leadership amounts to is inclusiveness. It is not a question of exclusiveness. Last year, I had gone to the North Pole in the dead of winter to chase the northern lights. Temperatures were minus 50. And I was told that if you really want to go deep into the pole to see the northern lights as beautifully as they can, you should go on a husky sled. So I thought that was fine, and I thought I'd have great fun doing it. And then I was told I had to be trained for it for some time. So I went into the training and found that we had to stand on little rails with a little stand and guide the huskies ourselves. But what it really did to me was a unique experience. I found of the 8 huskies which were drawing me and which I was meant to regulate, of course most of the time they were regulating me, I found that there was one husky which was on the inner side in the front, who kept looking back every now and then, who would suddenly slow down, who would suddenly move. You could see the harness slacken a bit, suddenly move more, and you could see the harness tighten. And I kept watching this. And when I got back, I asked the person who was running this entire lodge, I said, "What does all this mean?" He said, "That is the lead husky. And why she kept looking back was to see what everybody else was doing, to see if any of them were having a problem, in which case she would slow down for them, to see whether any of them needed more encouragement, in which case she would bark or yelp at them. But at every single second, she was fully aware of what the others were doing." You may be surprised why I kept saying she, but many of the students here, especially the girls, would be delighted to know that I was told that all the leaders of the packs were usually the female of the species. And I'm sure that that is something we in India have known for many, many years, and I think it's about time we respect. I have always maintained that leadership is not getting people to do what you want. It is getting people to want to do what you want. That is the true sign of leadership. The basic issue that every single person who aspires to be a leader should remember is that a leader leads by example. He cannot set a single standard that he cannot maintain himself. It was Benjamin Disraeli who said, "I follow the people. After all, am I not their leader?" It's such a telling line, because who is a leader without the people he is meant to guide? What is he but for the people he is meant to guide? And that is why the success of this institution will be decided by each one of you. And your roles is to see that each one of these students does this institution proud, in which case you will do this institution proud. And that is what I'm hoping that you will all be able to achieve this year. And that brings me to what unfortunately is one of my favorite topics, the issue of tolerance, the issue of inclusiveness. It is very sad that we as a generation are handing over to all these young school students today a world which is not a very happy world. We are handing over a world which is rampant with corruption, where there's ecological degradation to the core, which, as Woodrow Wilson said, is a world which is full of nuclear giants, but unfortunately moral infants. We are handing over a world which we cannot be very proud of having handed over. And that is why today, when we do pass the baton on to you, your job is really to start from square A. Please do not listen to bad examples you've been given over the years and which you are still being given. When I talk about tolerance in this context of your context, each one of you prefects has a duty to know what each student's abilities and disabilities are, to know what each student's weaknesses and strengths are, to be tolerant about their weaknesses. Because if you only expect people to agree with you, then I'm sorry, in the long run, you can never ever be a leader. It is always my belief that it is shameful to run away from those who disagree with us. It is far better to embrace them. And that is something which I would appeal to all of you as this generation to remember. Tolerance, as Justice Chinnappa Reddy of the Supreme Court said so beautifully when he was deciding the Kerala education case. This actually, I should tell you about this case because it's very interesting. And this really tells you what India is all about. There was this school in Kerala where two students did not sing the national anthem. They stood up very respectfully. They bowed before the flag, but they wouldn't sing the national anthem because they were Jehovah's Witnesses who could only sing songs in praise of their Lord, and therefore they said they couldn't sing the national anthem. The school rusticated them. They were expelled from the school. The case came up to the Supreme Court, and Justice Reddy starts his judgment with the words, "Tolerance runs like a thread through the Constitution of India," and went on to say they did not in any manner show any disrespect to the flag. They did not in any manner insult the flag. We should be tolerant for the fact that their own belief allows them to show respect in a slightly different way than maybe we would want to show that respect. That does not in any way make them disrespectful or people we should rusticate or remove from society. Let us really work, and your generation really work, at making it an inclusive society, not an exclusive one. And remember, at the end of your tenure, at the end of this year, everything depends on how you have been remembered. 1 year goes away very, very fast. But all the students today of this school will remember you 44 years from today, as I remember every single prefect when I was in school. And that is what you should think. What will you be thought of by them at that stage? I think I've been far too serious, so I shall conclude with a story I heard the other day of these three armed service officers who were sitting down and each one discussing about what their commanding officers were like. The first one said, "Oh, our commanding officer, what a chap he was. There he was in the front and a grenade burst right next to him. A part of his guts came tumbling out. They took him back, shoved his guts in, stitched him up, and a few days later he was commanding us as ever." The second one said, "Oh, that's nothing. Our commanding officer, there he was in the front, a shell fell there, and a part of his brain came out. Took him back, pushed his brain back in, stitched him up, commanded us day after day, as good as ever." Third said, "You guys, that's nothing. Our commanding officer, no brains, no guts, commanded us day after day, night after night, and didn't even take those days off." I'm sure that's not what you'll be. I'm sure all of you will do yourselves, your parents, your school, and your country proud. And in the process, every one of these students, every one of you, I believe, one day also will do so. Godspeed, good luck, and God bless.
Thank you, sir, for the inspiring speech and the encouraging words. May we now request the headmistress to present a memento to the chief guest. Please rise for the national anthem.